Good evening. First, we would like to start by thanking CCA and the Air Laboratory devoting team for hosting us and for exciting and very inspirational month. So my name is Yael Gilad, and we work as a curatorial duo under the name High and Low Bureau. We curate exhibitions, performative events, and film program, usually in collaboration with Art Institute in Europe and Israel. In our talk today, we will look into artistic practices that challenge notion of territory, belonging, and civil participation in the Israeli public sphere. Starting with a short historical context and moving to the current days, we will show how Israeli and Palestinian artists apply various tactics in order to trace, create, and imagine alternative narratives. We will also provide a short mapping of the Israeli art scene in terms of institution and art schools. Throughout the talk, we will go back again and again to the question of our position as curators and citizens and the way it is related to the issue of personal and collective responsibility. One of the reasons we choose to focus our presentation on art in public sphere came from the encounters we had here during the last month and the discussion between the members of the residency group. Another reason that, unlike the field of video art, which is flourishing in Israel and also gaining international acknowledgement, public art practices are less popular in Israel and consequently gain much less international attention. As you will see, most of the practices in that regard are still taking place on a symbolic and poetic level, and most of them still using video as the main tool of expression. This talk is a good opportunity to give visibility to this field, which is saturated with very interesting artistic activity. In addition, there were not many attempts to analyze Israeli art from this angle of public art practices, so for us, it is also kind of a professional challenge. Having said that, it is important to highlight that the works that we choose do not represent the full picture regarding public art in Israel. This is rather a subjective selection. So now we will start. Hello. Hi. Maybe we need to move just a bit. So we
want. This work that welcomes you when you enter the space is a work by Jerusalem-based artist Daniel Kicheles, titled The Messenger. The work is from 2011, and what we see is the artist standing on the ridge of Mount Scopus in Jerusalem, which is overlooking the Palestinian village of Elisawiya. A musician by profession, Kicheles is accompanying the village Muazzin's five daily prayers. As we saw, he creates a new musical interpretation to the prayer by playing along his own original score. And we thought to open the talk with this work, since it touches on a variety of issues relating to territory, identity, and positioning in Israel today. The ridge where Kicheles stands is the same ridge where Bezalel, the Israeli Academy of Art and Design, is located. He literally stands outside the academy fence, and the view that we see in the video is the exact same view that the students in the academy counter every day. Bezalel was established in 1906 after the Zionist Congress in Basel passes a resolution to establish an art school in Jerusalem. Since then, Bezalel is one of the landmarks in the history of Israeli art and definitely the most important and influential art school in Israel. Kicheles' decision to stand where Bezalel is located can be read as an attempt to create continuity with the tradition of Israeli art. However, facing Elisawiya, situated as the east part in the east part of Jerusalem, Kicheles offers a new perspective to where Israeli art should focus its horizon. It's an attempt to connect to his immediate surrounding, the Middle East region in general, and the Palestinian neighborhood in particular. What we find interesting about this work is that the attempt to affiliate oneself with the local environment, the attempt to create dialogue with the muezzin, also acknowledging the inherent power relation within the current political situation in Israel-Palestine. Kicheles looks at the village from above, from a vantage point, where he positions in a position that reminds a rock star facing his audience. He creates a cultural dialogue, but this is a one-sided dialogue, which is based on cultural appropriation. It is a bittersweet call for attention that is determined by the ongoing repression of the Palestinian society by the Israeli state. Kitchell's complex position represents, to a large extent, also our position in Israeli curators working inside and outside Israel. As offspring of East European immigrants, mainly Polish immigrants, we are part of the privileged Jewish majority in Israel. Although we are strongly against the Israeli occupation, we are part of the society that executes the system of oppression. Hence, we have to ask ourselves, are we in a position to create cultural dialogue from this predominant position? Is there a possibility to be part of the Israeli art scene without indirectly participating in the occupation regime? And is there a way for us to accompany the muezzin without appropriating it? The Messenger is already part of the mainstream of Israeli art. It was shown in a number of exhibitions, including our current exhibition taking place these days in the Israeli Center for Digital Art in Holon. It seems that by raising this question, Kitchelis is expressing thoughts and ideas of many Israelis, especially young ones. However, that wasn't always the case. The artistic exploration of the Israeli-Palestinian public sphere started far away from the mainstream cultural activity. It can be argued that Israeli artists before 67 war were either glorifying the Zionist narrative or glorifying the socialist ideology, or both. Only after Israel took over the West Bank, Gaza, and the Golan Heights in 67, artists started to develop a critical approach towards the Zionist ideology and its special manifestation.
For example, in 1972, artist Michael Drucks created a series of photos entitled Punishment to Stand in the Corner. In this work, that is already part of the canon of Israeli art, the artist sends himself to stand in the corner with his face to the wall in four different locations. His childhood school in Tel Aviv, the Western Wall, which is the holiest place for religious Jews, the Israeli Museum, and the Israeli Parliament in Jerusalem. This act of self-punishment takes place in the most charged site in Israel, underlining the strong link between individual experience and authority within public sphere. The work was one of the first to raise questions around the issues of obedience and disciplines of civil society, and symbolized the power relation between the artist and the almighty state institute. Another example is a series of activities created by Pinchas Cohen-Gan during the early 70s. Unlike Drucks' action that was purely symbolic, Cohen-Gan went to a Palestinian refugee camp near Jericho and built a temporary shelter consisting of two tents. He then invited two of the camp's inhabitants for a conversation about Israel in the year 2000. At the end of the conversation, he made a statement that refugee is someone who cannot return to his birthplace. Today, Cohen-Gan is an acclaimed artist, although still controversial. But back then, this action was a brave attempt to act in the contested public space, such as refugee camp, in order to discuss the notion of belonging, ownership, and precarious existence. These artists were pioneers in their critical approach and aesthetics, and their actions were unique in the Israeli context. As you can imagine, most of the public art in Israel are monuments and memorial sites. For instance, one quite very particular and quite amazing, the Negev Monument by artist Danny Caravan, who is responsible to many monuments and sculptures in the Israeli landscape. In recent years, there is a growing interest by artists to activate and problematize the public spaces through different action.
One of the most interesting works in this regard, or at least we found it very interesting, was created in 2007 by artist and activist Ronen Edelman, the Ghost of Manshia Awakes. It was a collective action in what used to be the Arab quarter of Manshia, just outside Jaffa. What is today, as we see, is a big park, and a big parking lot, and also a small museum to the one of the underground Jewish underground movements at 48. After the Israeli forces conquered the neighborhood in 48, it was repopulated by Jewish immigrants, and later the whole area was completely demolished. Using soccer field marking equipment and simple paint rollers, the artists mark out the grid of the streets and houses of the neighborhood, including the name of the main streets and important landmarks. It took almost 2 weeks for the marking to be erased, and during that time, people continue using the park regularly, having picnics and barbecues in the streets corners, main intersection, and inside public building. 2 years later, yes. Right, maybe you can just go back for.
Yes.
I think it's a very funny picture. 2 years later, tackling the issue of belonging and territory from a completely different angle, Palestinian-Israeli artist Rafat Khattab creating the already canonical work Untitled. We will show a small short extract from the work.
Okay, that's my part of the note.
In this work from 2009, the artist is gently watering and gardening an olive tree that is located in the middle of Rabin Square at the center of Tel Aviv. Two very important symbols are put into play here. The first one is the olive tree, the Palestinian national symbol, which refers to the Palestinian villages before 48, the year of the Palestinian Nakba, or the Palestinian disaster. The second symbol is Rabin Square, the official square for memorial ceremonies, Independence Day celebrations, and the place where Yitzhak Rabin, the Israeli Prime Minister, was assassinated. The Lebanese song, which accompanied the work, is about belonging to a place and the possibility or the impossibility to return to a place that you left. Khattab's works touch on the most sensitive issues for Jewish-Israeli society, such as the right of return of the Palestinian refugees and Rabin assassination. Yet, the work was exhibited in some of the most acclaimed Israeli museums. We would like to take this opportunity to shortly map the main institutes composing the Israeli art scene and their importance.
For many years, the National Israeli Museum in Jerusalem and the Tel Aviv Museum for Modern Art in Tel Aviv were the only important modern and contemporary art institution. However, both of the museums hold a more conservative approach. Parallel to them, a rich network of private galleries was developed, and many artists found this gallery as the most convenient context to develop their practice. In 1997, the Tel Aviv Center for Contemporary Art, the Tel Aviv version of CCA, was established, focusing mostly on video and performances, and brought new energy into the scene. That was the first sign for the opening and revival of different art institutes all over the country. The most important change happened in City Museum. This museum was established during the 50s and the 60s, usually as part of a bigger cultural center, consists of a city auditorium, library, and of course, a memorial center. Although this museum had their own collection, they usually didn't exhibit contemporary art or didn't have any influence on the local art scene. Starting from 2000, new and younger curators took over this peripheral museum and turned them into a major force in the Israeli art scene. Among these museums, Herzliya Museum, where Rafat Khattab work was first exhibited, and Petah Tikva Museum, for instance, which Dor Gez, a young and artist and already quite recognized internationally, was first exhibited. In both cases, the practice of this artist is very political and polemic, yet they were exhibited in the City Museum, which is fully publicly funded, and in the periphery. Following these changes, few new museums were open, such as the Museum of Photography in the north of Israel, and very recently, both the Israeli Museum in Tel Aviv and in Jerusalem recruited new curator. So this is actually a new period for Israeli art institutions. We also find especially important to mention the Israeli Center for Digital Art in Holon, which is one of the most prominent art institutes in Israel, dedicated to questioning art in public space and to the issue of community and participation. Most of the activity of the center are devoted to long-term involvement in the neighborhood they are situated in Holon. And in this regard, the center serves as an alternative to most of the art institutions in Israel. And what we see in this photo is a work by artist Meir Gal from 1996, where he marked in white the Central Museum in Israel in order to contextualize them as an extension of the state authority.
Maybe I would say one more word about this work, just to explain. In Israel, you cannot take a picture from the air without permission of the censor. And if the censor decides that there is a military places or buildings in the picture, so we mark them in white in order to block the view. So Meir Gal did the same with the museums, and in this way, saying something about the role of museums in Israeli society as someone extension or another manifestation of state authority.
Sorry?
Yeah. It's blurred. Yeah. But that was way before Google Earth. But yeah. In Google Earth it's blurred, and there's a few areas that you cannot see, and yeah, I already tried a few times. They work. Okay. Back to the topic of public art. As we see, many of the works dealing with the public space in Israel touch on issues related to the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. They offer alternative narrative to the Zionist narrative and create subversive act within the public sphere. This issue, however, since the 90s, more and more artists touch on civil issues that are not directly related to the conflict. This issue includes the power relation between different ethnic groups within the Jewish majority in Israel or the Israeli society at large, critique on the neoliberal economic system, and examination of the notion of civil participation. The performance group Public Movement may be considered to be one of the most known art group dealing with this issue in Israel in recent years. But since they're quite known in Poland and they were also guests of this center, we thought that maybe we just mention them and move on to other artists, such as Ariel Kleiner, who positioned a real guillotine in the main intersection in the city of Herzliya is part of the Herzliya Biennale, what you see here. However, this work got a lot of attention only 2 or 3 years later when the artist repositioned the work in the middle of Tel Aviv Central Boulevard, Rothschild Boulevard, at the peak of the summer of civil protest in 2011. What we see here in this picture, it's the cover of a magazine, and the guillotine was relocated right under one of the financial skyscrapers that are slowly taking over the boulevard. Taking into account the revolutionary spirit in the streets that summer, positioning the guillotine there was a disturbing act that the city hall, which can explain why the city hall dismantled the sculpture right away after a few hours. So this is about the work, and this is the skyscraper. Actually, we see two, one here and one here. And the whole boulevard, you can imagine, it's full of tents. It's like an occupied city, and this is right in the middle. So this is about the work, and the magazine itself that we see, the name is Ma'ayan. This magazine has an important part in promoting political art, that it's not only or slowly busy with the conflict. This is, you can say, almost the only art magazine published in Israel these days. It was established by a group of curators, artists, poets, and filmmakers. And this group is very, very visible in the Israeli art scene. They also curate exhibition, poetry events in public spaces such as McDonald's, for example, and publish two more magazines, one about poetry and another about cinema. The most known member of this group is the curator Joshua Simon, who is now the chief curator of the Bat Yam Museum, one of the peripheral museums that we mentioned before. I think that it's pretty similar to different protests in like the Occupy movement in the United States. It's about the high cost of living. Basically, it's about economic issues, about basically it's a middle class protest against conditions of living in the city and high prices.
Another artist group is Artim. They are running the project, the Levinsky Garden Library. The Levinsky Garden is located near Tel Aviv Central Station at the south part of the city, which is a poor and considered to be an unsafe area. It is a meeting place for refugees and migrant workers from different countries. This group of artists decided to create an open-air library in the park, arguing that the act of reading is a basic right of every human being. The library consists of a number of bookshelves with light coming from behind the books so they shine at night, and a small place for reading and meeting. It contains books in many different languages, and their strategy for categorizing the books is very special. In order to bypass culture barriers, they organize the books according to the emotion they provoke in the reader. Another artist that deals with the visibility of different minority groups in the public sphere is Nira Pereg. She is not acting in the public sphere, but rather documenting and observing it. In this work, Shabbat, she documented the closing of one of the Orthodox Jews' neighborhood in Jerusalem right before Shabbat is entering. In this Orthodox neighborhood, it is not recommended to drive your car during Shabbat. The residents take initiative and blocking the street for people outside their community. In this video, Perk explores the manifestation of social relationship in the urban space. And I will again do it smooth. So we will see a small part of it.
Yeah, this has happened every Friday.
Yeah. Before
Shabbat entering, and you cannot enter the neighborhood later. Yeah, later in the video also you see like there's like one taxi driver is really right, like it's like minute, I have more 10 minutes before Shabbat, so let me in. He's like, no, you stand out. So one of the main cultural events in recent years taking place in Israel is the Jerusalem Season of Culture. It is a private funded organization that initiates and supports different cultural activities taking place in Jerusalem during the summer. One of the season's main events is Under the Mountain Festival, which is dedicated to new public art. The artistic manager of the festival is Omer Krieger, one of the founders of Public Movement, and it contains few interesting projects. One of them took place last year and touched on one of the most debated issues in Israeli society, the discrimination of Arab Jews, meaning Jews who immigrate to Israel from Arab countries. The project, the Watermelon Stand, was initiated by a group of Jerusalem-based artists called Muslala. The group works in a public space and focuses on durational and participatory urban practices. The name Muslala is a play on the name of the neighborhood where the group operates, Musrara. Musrara neighborhood is located on the borderline between West and East Jerusalem. Before 48, it was a Palestinian neighborhood, and after 48, this neighborhood was populated by Jewish immigrants from Arab countries. During the 50s, it was the first place in Israel where protests against the discrimination of Arab Jews took place. In the Watermelon Stand project, the Muslala group recreated an urban space that once used to host watermelon stands. These stands were owned by both Palestinian and residents of the neighborhood. The place was not only a model for coexistence between Palestinian and Israelis, but also gave visibility to Arab Jews in the public sphere. However, the area was demolished to allow the pavement of an highway during the 80s, and the watermelon stands disappeared from the landscape. For the project, the group invited the former owners of the stands, as well as musicians and artists, both Palestinians and Israelis from Arab origin, to participate in a few days of happening. The participants, as well as passersby, sat together, play music, talk to each other, and mostly ate watermelons. In a reality of almost complete separation between Jews and Arabs, events such as this that underlines the mutual history and tradition of Muslim, Christian, and Jewish people from Arab origins had a radical political meaning. However, after a few days, people started to blame each other for racism, violence, and sexual harassment, and the environment in the place became much less friendly. Since we mentioned the neighborhood of Musrara, we would like also to mention there is an art school operating within the neighborhood, the Musrara Art School, which is specialized in photography, and the students there are mainly work together with the local community. This is an art school with a clear social orientation, which makes it very unique. The school is part of a boost of new independent art school opened in Israel in the last 20 years. Other schools, for example, are Hamidrasha, which already managed to produce few really interesting artists and acclaimed artists, like Guy Ben-Air, which is pretty famous, and Mika Rotenberg. Minshar Art School, where important Israeli theorists such as Ariella Azulay used to teach, and the new art department of the Shinkar School of Design. These schools have an important contribution to the flourishing of Israeli art scene since the 90s.
We would like to end this talk by showing you, by talking about this work of Ohad Fishov. Fishov is known as the lead singer of one of the legendary rock band ever existed in Israel, Nosei HaMikbaat. In the last decade, he works mainly in a dance context and as a performer and teacher. This work is a second part of a series of performative events called Slow Walks, where he walks very slow in an intense urban environment. The first walk took place in 2005 on London Bridge, while the second walk happened again in the 10th city that we mentioned before, of Rothschild Boulevard, Tel Aviv, during the summer protest of 2011. Fishov walked a whole day without stop for water or food in a speed of 1 meter per minute. Few people joined him for different part of the walk. In an interview, he stated that for him, the walk is a physical conceptualization of value that he considered important in the context of a long-term social struggle, perseverance, patience, and personal commitment. Sorry. This work, together with Daniel Kichelis, that we opened this talk with, are both part of the exhibition we opened 6 weeks ago in the Israeli Center for Digital Art, titled Time Resistance. But the main reason we choose these two works to open and close the presentation is that we believe that they both underline the new question public art in Israel is asking, a question that we, as curators, are very interested in. What is our responsibility as citizens? How can we link the inner conflict within the Israeli society to the struggle for ending the Israeli occupation? And what is the role of artists in the process, especially artists that are deeply involved in the reality around them, such as artists who work in the public sphere? Thank you.
Thank you. It was quite short, you know, so you're very welcome to ask questions.
And for Vladimir that you will...
Vladimir, it was for you. So
you can catch his flight.
Yes. I'm sure you have a question, Gosha.
I wanted to ask about this Ronel Eidelman work. Mm-hmm. Yes, I wasn't sure what did it say, and you said that it lasted 2 weeks before it was removed, yeah. And by whom it was removed.
It was... designs on a football team, so it's naturally disappeared.
Oh, just like that?
Yeah.
Okay, and what did it say?
The name of the streets.
The name of the streets and the buildings. Okay. So, like, you can walk in the main street, what used to be our village, and, okay. Yeah. So he was mapping the quarter.
I can't read my questions. So I'm ready to pass on the microphone, if there are any questions.
Hi, thanks. Two questions. One, maybe it's me, but it seemed like there are a lot more male artists shown here than women. What's up with that? And number two, could we talk a little more about the library, how long it's been up, etc.?
Yeah. First question, you're right, there was also a debate amongst us. What we will say that all the groups that we mentioned, the collective one, are the group between like women and males. So there are a few of them that are kind of a collaboration and some of them, and you're right. And about the library, I will find it again.
Open. It's important to say that there's many female artists in, I think there's more female artists in the Israel art scene. But we choose a very specific kind of works because also in the framework of this residency and the talks that we had. And among these very specific practices, there weren't many women. There was some, and we also tried to give a bit of that. But this imbalance is just mainly about this very specific kind of practice, but it doesn't reflect the whole art scene. And I guess that's a broader research on this topic may bring different results.
So the Garden Library started in 2009 by artist Natalie Flosser, who is a very interesting painter working with Zomer Art Gallery, and Romy Achitov and Lior Waterman. There are a few of them. And it started as an initiative to do something in that area, which is every day is even more contested and becoming violent and not an easy space around it, especially also because of police harassment, and there are many, many obstacles around that. And basically, they started doing it with donation. People started to donate books. And then there is one particular organization working in the South and working with migrant workers that started to collaborate with them. And actually, every few months, they're also facing a risk of closing because they don't have enough infrastructure. And actually, just recently, they again got more donations. So it's a lot of voluntary works from this group of our team, but also from SILA, which are the organization, and from people that from once in a while helping them. And what they're doing, they're also doing different kinds of reading groups, sessions, and music. Like it really become the space itself becoming around it a place for gathering for children, but not only. Yeah, I think that it's mainly because the refugees issues. It's a very one of the most contested issues nowadays, and I think it is an attempt to work within what's going on now, and in terms of not only to protest but also to suggest and to suggest a social cultural space. So it's not only about a place. It's a political by being it, but it's just for creating an everyday and something more, much more that they are missing. So I think it's more in that, like creating this, that kind of an idea. And it's not, of course, it's an educating place, but I think it's also about just bringing what they can bring, and they're coming from art, so they're also kind of a dance, very, very interesting dance group that came out of that gathering, and a music.
There's also the Levinsky Soup.
Yeah, but
group.
That's
Yeah, it's a group of activists, it's not part of them, but they're also operating the same garden and they're providing food for the immigrants, but it's a different project. So.
Thank you for some very interesting artworks. I have a few thoughts and a few questions. One, going back to the earlier question about women artists, and I want to know whether public space and women's involvement in public space is one, like, could be a dynamic that could influence the number of artworks that are particularly contentious when it comes to public artwork. So, like, what is there a relationship between women in public space and the art production? That's the first question. And the second question is, I'm very interested in the relationship between violence in public space and community. And it seems like there are two, I saw two trends or two threads perhaps. And I'm very interested in how both are received. You kind of started talking about that, like, works that are dismantled or works that are that become unfriendly spaces, like you said. But perhaps do you see a future development of such works and how those dynamics will play out? So,
I will start with the last question. Yes, most of the works that we showed here, and actually most of the work in the last years are temporary, that the works that either happen in a specific context or they were dismantled, or like there are different aspects of why it became, but it's temporary. So this is also something to think, I think, in a larger idea, like why all of them are temporary. And it's something which I think relating very much to Israel, but there is, there is no kind of a horizon of a future or something very stable. So also the work that you're doing is something that you're showing at the moment, and you're reacting what you feel, like you just go outside or you develop something, but it's much more for the time being, let's say. And so that in that regard, so there are not many, most of the works were kind of deliberate, either temporarily to close after the period of time, or they were dismantled by this specific war of the guillotine. And yes, I do think that the moment you are doing something provocative and also in a very, let's say, specific moment in time, you will get reaction and it can get violent. I think such as happening with the guillotine, I think, and also with the watermelon stand. But it's very depend, because now we're showing you all of that. It's important to say that, except the Garden Library, like it's it didn't have so much attention. It's not like the works are like the most acclaimed works we can tell you about in the history of Israeli art. So that was also kind of our idea to show those works that actually we found very important. So in that regard, I think that, yeah, it could raise. I think it definitely, I would like to see more of a public project or going to the space and activating it. And I think it will also have the possibility to raise either a discussion, but also raise much more than a discussion. I think it's important.
Yeah, I will just add to that. It's interesting because also during also the research for this presentation, it is in Jerusalem, which is not the center of artistic production in Israel. The center is Tel Aviv, of course. But in Jerusalem, which is a very, very problematic city, and it's really hard to walk there, and everything is holy, and everywhere you go, you have a soldier with guns, and like, it's a crazy place. In Jerusalem, there's much more, artists involving in as groups working in the public space. For example, this group, Muslala, they're very active. Like, you can see them around the city, they're doing different activities. So it's interesting, if I think about it, in Tel Aviv, for example, there is no like groups going together and creating these kind of projects, like once in a while. But in Jerusalem, because the reality is much harsh, it's happening much more. So also interesting, because they are in a big danger, comparing to Tel Aviv, which is more like loose.
And in terms of the other question, as also Gilad mentioned, a lot of women artists are one of the most kind of prominent makers in the Israeli art field. So they are like kind of they are making the more controversial, interesting, challenging works. And even, you know, Nira Perek, she as a woman taking this picture among all the religious Jews, that was also something quite brave to do, and she's doing it along, like a lot of her works are dealing with religious places actually, and she goes there by herself and she's creating her relationships. So on the contrary, I would say that I wouldn't say that there is a kind of a discrimination. I think that there is something about very inspiring of women artists and how they activate with their work or in the public space with their practices.
Yeah, but it is true that a few times also I participated in one of the events and during this summer of protest, and there was also a camp in this Levinsky Garden, and very soon it's become there's become an issue of sexual harassment come out, and then the women in the camp, because it was a group of activists trying, you know, work together with the refugees, so they decided to position the tents as in a circle, okay, that it will be blocked from the outside, so like to feel more protected. And then I participated in one discussion there that someone says that actually what they did with putting the tents like that is a kind of reacting the model of Choma u'Migdal, which is the same model that Yael Bartonai is using in the second video of her work. This is structure of like you have a square wall and then a tower in the middle, which was kind of a Zionist strategy to take over the land during the 30s and the 40s. So actually in a way from radical activists today kind of imitating the same technique, how to protect the area in order to block other people to come in. So it was a whole discussion about it. So yeah, it seems that when people try to work with different communities, like in the case in Jerusalem or this case of Levinsky, this issue of sexual harassment is popping out, and it's like there is like it's make everything much more complicated.
Yeah, like I think I will just summarize by saying that there are very big issues of sexual harassment and offense through the women in the streets of Israel. I would say that from the artistic point of view, what I can get inspired is how to reclaim that space and how to attack those issues and to tackle that idea. So if it answers your question.
I just wanted to follow on your last point about looking inside and secluding and finding a sphere, because many of the works seem to be referring directly to history or to the condition of Israel itself and not really speaking about Palestine, for example. So can you speak a bit more about that? That's one of the questions.
There is no so many works working directly with the Palestinians. First, because I guess most artists is easier for them to work within the history, within like the green line, what we call, and less working in the settlements or working in the West Bank. There's few works and corporations, but there are not many. And also, I think that in the last few years, there's less and less Palestinian artists willing to cooperate with Israeli artists.
There are a lot of works dealing with that. Actually, also mainly video works, I would say. And there was a very, very interesting and important project called Liminal Spaces, and that happened 5-6 years ago, something like that. I think six. I don't have the exact number. And that was it became one of the most known attempts to collaborate between curators, artists from Palestine and from Israel. It was also part of the Digital Art Lab. I really recommend to look in the website about this project. And that was the idea of how to create a group, and it was visit also in Jerusalem, in East Jerusalem, in Ramallah, there was this notion. But it was 5 years ago, and as you know, the situation even deteriorated since then. And the possibility to connect or to create those bridges are just actually vanishing. And which is also part of we also decide, okay, we will focus on from the Israeli side. And it's also part of this kind of an isolation, a very sad and depressing isolation, which I hope we will not get into that into detail, but because I do hope that eventually it will come out of it, because there is kind of a moment of each of us, the Israeli artists are dealing on the topic from their perspective, and the Palestinian artists are dealing it from their perspective. I hope that in the future there will be also more exchange, because then you find so many works in familiar, so many practices in that. So there are works, but not necessarily going there, because there's also a question if you go there, in which position are you going there? Because we have the possibility to go there, but they don't have the possibility to come to us.
Yeah, but there's few photographers, I think Israeli artists, because of this positioning problem, they work, if they do work in the Palestinian territories, they work near settlements. So there's few, Efrat Shvili and different, Miki Kartzman, photographers were going to settlements, to the West Bank, and photograph the settlements, the army, Avi Mugrabi work that now became quite, he's a documentarist originally, but now it became quite known in the art field. He makes these documentaries where he go to the Palestinian territories and confront the Israeli soldiers. It's really hard to watch. It's very violent. And so yes, there is Israeli artists working in this field, but less about these kind of practices.
It's the last question on this subject. Is still thinking about the public space, because you were showing mostly those kinds of works, and was there any exposure putting those sorts of questions, for example, about Palestine in the public space throughout? And if there were, what sort of responses did it get?
And what?
Responses. There were, but it's true that in terms of looking at, let's say, from the prism of public art practices, I would say that, for instance, what Ronen Indelman did, it's still considered to be one of the most kind of controversial and known one, because to talk about 48 in the Israeli society is not something grounded. People are, the majority of people not referring to that as the Nakba, and not referring to what actually happened in 48 and what happened to the Palestinian refugees. So also this act, which might seem symbolic, to do it in Israel actually have a very radical approach. So I think it's also to look at like the poetic or the gesture that contains within them this radicality. And yes, there are works, but I think there, again, there are more video and photography that going there in terms of kind of relating with like actual manifestation. And in terms of receiveness, I think that this is kind of, again, this this I would say irony or questionable discourse in Israel, because all of the artists, especially like, of course, Yael Bartana, Avi Mugrabi, they're dealing with the issues in a very, very sophisticated approach, and they are very well received in Israel. And they are kind of dealing with those issues, but of course, unfortunately, it's still in the art scene and in the art field, so it's still not considered to be so dangerous to kind of infiltrate to the Israeli consensus.
It's been categorized as a radical left, you know, so.
Yeah,
so it's like, okay, radical left, but for example, as far as I know, this work of Ronen Edelman and other works, they didn't like the public reaction. People didn't care so much. Also, we see for the picture, like they were sitting there, but they didn't really care that it's like have an Arab name and actually it's a street. So, yeah, there's one of a group, Remember Zohrot, which dealing with 48 directly, and also they involved with Ariela Azulay. So they're focused on this issue, but it's a very minor activities. It's not big enough to really get the public attention.
May I ask, thank you for great works. May I ask what kind of institutional support these artists had, like in terms of funding, if it's private or public, and in terms of permissions, like was it easy to get a permission to draw those lines? And the second question would be if these works get enough media attention, like what is the state of media in Israel, if they pick up these subjects or they don't speak about it?
Okay, you want to talk about the media and I will talk about
I just answer quickly about the media. No, they're not getting a lot of media attention. But most of them, well, it also depends. For example, the watermelon stands, because it was part of an institute and it was part of the festival, so it got much more media attention than Ronen Edelman work, that I don't know if it was completely independent, but it wasn't part of a bigger organization. So it depends on the thing. And also it's important to say that, for example, the stand melon, the watermelon stand, our reading of it is very political, but the way it was exhibited to the people or into the media, it's, you know, let's get together, it's a watermelon. So it was also presented as a not such a political issue, and this is also why it won more public attention.
I will say generally that most of the project were self-initiative, and then they approach institution, but it depends. With Ronen Edelman, it was kind of, there is a group we're dealing with Jaffa and the remembrance of Jaffa, so they did it, but it wasn't very, they didn't need a lot of also authorization in order to do that. With the watermelon, I think it's more of a collaboration with the neighborhood than with the city. I think you can see that actually the most controversial piece that we showed here was the guillotine, and that was completely dismantled, but we still don't know who dismantled it.
The city hall. Yeah, but also the guillotine, because when it was created for the Herzliya Biennale, so it wasn't political, because it was, you know, like an artwork in the public space, and the Biennale, I guess, was commissioned the work, or at least get the right permission to put the work there in the intersection. Only later, when he decided to reposition it in the main boulevard, this is when it's become political.
But for instance, so this Under the Mountain, what Omar Krieger is doing, so now there is kind of a context to show those works. And most of the works, it was just, you know, this group of artists deciding to do something, and then all of a sudden, I think that was actually very exciting, that going on now, that all of a sudden there's when contextualizing this, all of a sudden, yeah, well, if we put it this and we call it new public art, what does it mean? And what does it mean you to do to put a guillotine in relation to all the other monuments? So it's more, I think, a contextualization and legitimation within the art field. And some of them, if they really need approval, it will be in with collaboration with art institution. But most of the project here, even the Levinsky Garden, it started for self-initiative. So the money, it's, well, with Ronen Edelman, for instance, I don't think there was any money involved. With the watermelon, so it was part of the Jerusalem season culture. The library, now that they're getting some kind of donation, I think also that with the Mesila, the organization that also in collaboration with the city, but most of it is between donation and public. And what else did we show? Ohad Fishop, of course, it's just he's doing it by himself.
And also all the Muslala works, the all I think the watermelon stand was the first time they cooperate with the City Hall. Until then, all the activities that they do, it's sharing self-initiatives, and they don't get money from the City Hall. They even refuse to get money from the art school working in the same neighborhood. And I work with one of them on another project in public space, and I know how hard it was for him to, we had to work with the authorities, and it was really hard for him, like, to have authorities involved. So I think basically they prefer to do it their own way.
So I have a question about your positionality. I know that I mean the audience is not familiar with your collective, High and Low Bureau, in terms of the kind of group dynamics and collective, strategies perhaps of collectivity that you shared with us, and I really appreciate those strategies. So now that you are moving back to Israel and you are curators, what are you going to do when you head back? What are you going to do, and how are you going to sustain those strategies of collectivity? How are you going to push the envelope?
First, we're going to freak out. Well, I can say for myself. I'm freaking out. I'm also saying we're not going back, we're going for a few years. I think those questions that you're asking now, those are the questions that I'm asking myself every day. Like, okay, now with all this, what does it mean to go back? And I know that we will still work between Europe and Israel, because this is also how the network and the project that we are doing are also taking place outside. But I think also following this month and following our interest is very much what can we bring also there, and how can we, what is it still to be done? Because there are a lot of things to be done. And I mentioned these moments of despair and the moment, okay, but actually there is nothing that we can do to change the situation, and which I think it's a very unproductive and not positive a place to be in. And I think what we would like to do is to bring what we have, the experience, our creation, and to collaborate with artists that we've been following for a few years now, and to think about new tactics and to learn, and you know, to continue this moment of exchange. Like, you know, we are still outsiders, and we've been working and seeing also for myself, because I've been working in a project in public space outside in Amsterdam, and which is very kind of comfortable, and you have the money and you have the authority and nothing will be controversial more or less, and all of a sudden to bring this knowledge and to think what it is that we can do there. And yeah, I think so. Those, what I can say, those questions with something that we would like to bring in. And I know more practically that for the moment, I don't think we would like to completely devote it to one institution, rather than to think how can we also start like grassroots and think how to contribute differently to the context. And we're already doing it, because for us, you know, to do this exhibition in Holon is something, and we're all the time kind of working between project to project. Yes, you know, maybe I took over that.
It's a great question. Like, it's the hardest question for us. one or more philosophical level, I can say that it's also something that we try to kind of put in the presentation. I don't know if it came out this way. During this summer of protests that we're going back and back talk about, so there was a lot of criticism about this process that it doesn't address the occupation issue. It was more like inner problem within the Jewish-Israeli society, basically. And Ariella Azoulay, in a text that she wrote about the protest, she said something interesting. She said, we shouldn't think about Israeli society of like these two poles of like Israelis, Palestinian. Okay, we should think about all of us as subjects of the Israeli authority, okay, on different levels. And by going out to the street, and by the way, 7% of the Israeli society went to the street during the summer. And in percentages, it's the largest group, like largest protests that were in the world. Although Israel is a very small place, so 7%, it's not a lot. But if you think about 7% in other places, that's a lot of people. So she said, what we should focus on is to kind of practice this act of citizenship, of becoming citizen, becoming an active citizen. And there's something about this protest that this is the practicing process. And also there's so many initiatives coming out of this protest, so it works. You know, people become much more aware of what's happening in society. So basically what she's trying to say, or maybe it's my own interpretation, or maybe I just hold to this as my hope in a way, coming back to Israel, is that this muscle of civic participation, maybe now it's mostly take place within the discussion, the inner problem of the Jewish society, but once you get this consciousness, this civil consciousness, it will also affect what's happening with the Palestinian, because then we start to see ourselves as kind of we are subjected to the same authority in a way. Although, of course, the Jewish have much more rights and so. So for me, this is a place that I can relate and said, okay, if I will start acting as a more active citizen, maybe later it will influence also what's happening with the occupation. Because right now the situation is that if you do something to end the occupation, or like, you know, you're going to a protest, or there's also a period when we used to do it in the past, it's very depressing. You're immediately being categorized as a radical left, and it's not productive. Like, it doesn't work. So we have to look about different way to look at the situation. And for us also, we try to show it in this work, like how becoming more aware as a citizen will hopefully in the end will also contribute to the situation as a whole.
Thank you very much.